Welcome to ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers. Today, we're at the home of the NFL's Cincinnati Bengals, Paul Brown Stadium in downtown Cincinnati, for a Big East matchup between the West Virginia Mountaineers and the 23rd-ranked Cincinnati Bearcats. Cincinnati is the lone unbeaten in conference play, and West Virginia needs a win today to get back in the thick of the conference race. So nice to have you with us, Mark Neely with Ray Bentley. Ray, both these teams have been a surprise in conference play this season, but for opposite reasons.
Yeah, you look at it, and West Virginia picked to win this thing. Consensus, have the best talent in the Big East, and yet they've lost two games at Syracuse and last week against Louisville. And then we already saw the standings there. Cincinnati, 3-0. Have won six in a row. Yeah. Pretty good football team.
And you look at each team's head coach, both still relatively new to their respective programs, but both can be very animated on the sidelines.
Yeah, you've got two really fiery guys here that run that football program for each of these respective universities. And the one that stands out to me, though, is Butch Jones. You see a lot of negative things coming from coaches, getting in kids' faces and all that. Butch is as positive with his players as any coach on the sidelines right now, and his kids really respond to that.
Great quarterback matchup today for West Virginia, Geno Smith. He's a junior now, but West Virginia's even more dependent on his arm.
Boy, and he's got a good arm. That's a good one to depend on. He can launch the deep ball. He's got enough wits about him to know when to run. He can get it done effectively that way. Now, on the other side, Zach Collaros is the quarterback for Cincinnati. He is the legitimate dual threat type of guy. Very comfortable in this offense. In fact, talk to Mike Bajakian, the offensive coordinator. He gives Collaros a ton of freedom to make decisions with audibles and matchups at the line.
Great day for football, 55 degrees. The wind can always be a weird issue here at Paul Brown Stadium, so we'll watch that. Cincinnati won the toss and have deferred, so West Virginia will receive. From the 3-yard line, Tavon Austin hits the 20 to the sideline, to the 25, steps out across the 25-yard line. Take a look at today's impact players, brought to you by Chick-fil-A for when the Mountaineers have the football.
Well, Stedman Bailey's got six 100-yard receiving games this year. He just finds a way to make plays. He's an outstanding receiver, and he's got a partner with him in Tavon Austin. He is a threat to go the distance on any given play. In fact, Butch Jones said that's the one guy that scares him more than anybody else. And then on the other side, J.K. Schaefer, the linebacker, the big leader for the Bearcat defense.
So the Mountaineers begin at their own 28-yard line. Smith the throw on first down, immediately getting hit at the 20 and dropped. John Hughes, the nose guard.
And Hughes just busts through it. Here he is, the nose tackle. And he beats one man, and then he just blows right past the running back, Ryan Clark. That was just a mismatch.
That pushes him back to the 21, a loss of 7. Second out at 17. 5 receivers, trips to the left for Smith in the empty backfield. Smith lets it go across the middle and incomplete at the 31-yard line. Urban, the intended receiver, and the strong safety, Drew Fry, with the coverage.
Drew Fry, when you watch this Cincinnati team on tape, he shows up all over the place, and you can see this is a really good defense, ranked in the top 10 in several categories, tackle for loss, sacks, and then the rush yards that they allow per game is key.
West Virginia needs to get to the 39 for a first down, 3rd and 17 on this first possession, and Smith being chased just dumps it. The pressure from Derek Wolfe. Surprised we didn't see intentional grounding. Is there a Mountaineer in the vicinity? No flag, but Syracuse was the team that really put a lot of pressure on Geno Smith the several weeks back and had success. Cincinnati, his first possession of West Virginia, putting the heat on Geno Smith.
Great defensive start for the Bearcats.
Michael Molinari to punt, standing at his own 6-yard line. And now we have a pre-snap snap whistle.
CFB, offense, number 48, 5 yards, 4 down.
So referee Tracy Jones, and that'll cost West Virginia 5 more, and this time push the punter Molinari right near his own goal line.
Special teams is going to be huge in this ball game today. Both coaches talked about it, saying that's where the difference could be made.
Well, West Virginia had a nightmare game on special teams a week ago, and they lost to Louisville, and a Molinari punt does take a West Virginia bounce, but rolls out of bounds at the 46-yard line. Great starting field position for Cincinnati. Let's take a look at the Chick-fil-A impact players.
Well, it starts with the running game and Isaiah Pede, and he's an outstanding back. He can get the edge as quick as anybody. He'll make you miss. He'll go the distance. And then Kembrell Tompkins has turned into their big play receiver. You know, he leads the team in receptions, but if they're going to go with a long one, this is the guy they like to get it to. And on the other side, Keith Tandy in the secondary for the Mountaineers. He's going to have to slow down Tompkins today.
4 receivers. Handoff. Pede spins at midfield. Push back, but forward progress should get him around the 48-yard line of West Virginia. Javon Snow, the middle linebacker, pushed him back. It is a gain of 6 on first down for Pede.
This Cincinnati offense will go fast, and they'll move Pede all over the place, this, you know, to hide him and things of that nature. And then when they have this 3-by-1, they love to throw it up top.
Looking for Tompkins. He finds him. He has a first down. Up to the 40-yard line of West Virginia. Travis Bell, the free safety, made the tackle for the Mountaineers.
They knew they had the one-on-one up there, and a simple little, I called it a read screen. He's just going to run a slant inside, and then they run it back to the flat, and that's what pulled out Najee Good, the underneath coverage, and that opened up the slant route.
Hand off, Pede running left, finds a little bit of a hole, stays on his feet, inside the 30, down the sideline. Pede!
Oh, man.
What a run! Isaiah Pede, his 9th rushing touchdown of the season. Right guard Austin Bujnak is one of the first to lay down a block to free him, and Pede scores from 40 yards.
Oh, he got a nice block at the end of this thing, too, and then he really set it up by breaking a tackle. Here he is. This is the tackle right here that he breaks. I mean, Juwan Snow had him wrapped up. Now you see the late blocks coming in. Right there, a pancake. By number 89, just knocking people down at the end of the play, was Demetrius Richardson, the tight end.
Point after for Tony Miliano. Isaiah Pede, a 40-yard touchdown run on the Bearcats' first possession, and Cincinnati leads early 7-0.
Nobody does.
But Georgia's Bearcats needed less than a minute and only 3 plays. And I know, Ray, it's only been 1 possession for each team, but an early tone has been set. All the pressure the Cincinnati defense put on quarterback Geno Smith of West Virginia, and then Pede with the 40-yard touchdown run.
Well, you know, one team came out here ready to play thus far. Now, that doesn't mean it's going to keep going on this way, but Cincinnati was ready to go from the get-go. We'll see if West Virginia can wake up and rebound and get themselves going. But right now, not only are they being beat 7-0 on the scoreboard, they're getting knocked all over the field. There was several pancake type blocks on Pede's touchdown run.
Well, this is not out of the ordinary for West Virginia. They're playing in their 10th game of the season. They have trailed in all 10 of those games. They're behind early in this one. Austin maneuvers to the 7. After fumbling the football, picks it back up, gets to the 15, 20, 25 down the sideline. A flag is out. Out of bounds near the 42 is Austin. Pat O'Donnell, the kicker, ran him out, but the flag came out back around the 35.
And that Austin, I mentioned it at the top, is dangerous.
Holding. Number 15 on the receiving team. 10-yard penalty. First down.
Well, Austin is not just a great wide receiver. They use him in so many different roles. Kickoff return, punt return. He'll even rush the football.
Yeah, had an 80-yarder against Rutgers a couple of weeks ago to get things rolling there. And he's explosive. He can go the distance anytime he touches the football.
Almost 16 yards every time he touches the football for West Virginia.
That's pretty good. Is he second in the country?
He is.
In all-purpose yards?
Behind the Michael James of Oregon. Handoff Dustin Garrison spins to the 25-yard line. Malik Bomar, the weak side linebacker, brings him down. Here's Malik Bomar, a junior from right here in Cincinnati, Winton Woods High School. His brother Taj played at Washington. Dad Jerry played college football at Marshall. Second down and 6. In motion goes Austin, and they flip it to him, and there goes Austin headed to the edge, turns the corner, and right near the marker, out of bounds, pushed out by Drew Fry. This is a forward pass.
Yeah, it's an interesting little play. It's probably the least challenging pass. Here, you're going to get motion across here, and then watch, it's just a little flip forward, a forward pass, an easy one, but a pass nonetheless, and then Austin, with the speed, is able to get the edge and the first down.
A flip, a mini shovel, I don't know what you want to call it, but it's not in the air very long. Garrison and Bowie in the backfield.
That's almost a lateral.
That's Garrison. It indeed looked like a lateral, but up to the 41-yard line. Again, Drew Fry with the tackle.
Yeah, I think this will go down as a run. As you see, watch, he's going to throw the ball from about the 26 right here. And you see the catch being made at the 25. So I would consider that a lateral. Not that it makes much of a difference. It'll show up differently in the stats as either a run or a pass. But a good play nonetheless. And you see this West Virginia offense trying to attack the perimeter of the Cincinnati defense in the last couple of plays.
Well, there is a Cincinnati player down. That is Drew Fry, who's been active already with a couple of tackles.
They don't want to lose Drew Fry. He's free safety, the leader back there.
So we'll step aside with 11:55 left in this first quarter. Dana Holgerson has the reputation of being a bit of a riverboat gambler.
Nice.
His offense.
Like I see what you're doing there. That's good. I like that.
Good news, Drew Fry got up under his own power and went to the sideline. Second down and 3 for West Virginia. Alston now in the backfield for the Mountaineers. 3 receivers to the right. And Smith looks to throw. And caught by Bailey. West Virginia answers. Stedman Bailey, a 59-yard touchdown.
Oh, and it appeared to me that Bailey got away with a little bit of a push-off as he's working on Cameron Cheatham. And what a perfect throw. Here it is. Press coverage from Cheatham. You see, he's got the hand on there. And not from that angle, you couldn't see any push off at all. But a great throw. And that's the quick strike nature of this offense and Geno Smith's ability to be on target with down the field throws.
Tyler Bittencourt on for the point after out of the hold of Michael Molinari. And West Virginia answers with a touchdown drive of their own. Geno Smith finding Stedman Bailey. 10th touchdown catch of the year for Bailey. We're still early in this first quarter, but now tied at 7.
Those stakes tonight.
Kick off for Corey Smith. In the end zone, Abernathy will not bring it out. Let's take a look at this week's BC Beavers right. And Pete in the backfield. Tavares hands it off. Pete stumbles this time. Falls forward near the 25-yard line. He does pick up about 3 yards. Marking down at the 23.
Yeah, Pete had a really nice hole there, and he just tripped. He could have been off to the races again.
Tompkins, the receiver, wide left at the top of the screen. Play fake. Kolaris looking left, throws left, complete. McClung upended at the 40-yard line. That goes for 17 yards. First down, Bearcats.
This is a great job of Zach Kolaris, just staying with that route and that receiver. McClung started in the slot on the other side and ran all the way across the formation, and Kolaris had time.
Kolaris swings it out to Pede. Down the sideline, eludes a couple of defenders to the 41-yard line of West Virginia. There was a couple of white shirts around midfield, Ray. I thought I had a shot at him, and he just zipped right past him.
He faked everybody out. Wow. He even fakes his own blocker out. The left tackle, you see 59, Hoffman go out there, and he wasn't even sure who to go block or what to do. Pede is electric when he gets out in space.
These are some moves. First down, Bearcats. Number 41 of the Mountaineers. Right back in the arms of Pede. Cuts it back, finds a hole. Breaks another tackle. Down the sideline, wrapped up around the five. He almost went again. Gain of 33. Even his quarterback, Kolaris, helping lay a block. Darwin Cook eventually made the tackle for West Virginia.
This is a great cut that Pede makes. He runs into the wall right there. He stops. He's going to shoot right through here. Now, Kolaris is up here. He's going to end up making a block for him. See him leading the way now? Just almost gets a piece of Jenkins to stop him.
George Wynn takes over in the backfield, and not exactly how you draw up the handoff, but they keep possession and advance it to the 6-yard line. A tackle by Julian Miller, the defensive tackle. Bearcats fortunate there on that snap. That was juggled right into the arms of Wynn.
This is where spread offenses sometimes will bog down. Having the ability to score in smaller spaces, because the whole idea of the spread is to take advantage of all the space. You run out of that space when you get down here inside the 10.
Four receivers, three to the left. Takes the handoff. Kolaris to the back of the end zone, too high and incomplete. McClung was the intended receiver.
This is where I believe you have to run your quarterback. And when we talked to Mike Bajakian, the offensive coordinator for the Bearcats, he said, hey, it's no secret that we like to run our quarterback in the red zone and then in short yardage situations. And a lot of times they'll clear everybody out and send all the receivers out, get into an empty, and let him run. We'll see if they want to do that here. It might be just a little too long with 6 yards to go.
Yeah, third and goal from the six. Tipped. Almost intercepted. A flag is out.
All right, Jared Barber's going to have nightmares over that one.
Well, good deflected it. And as you mentioned, Barber could not hang on.
Might be pass interference, except that the ball was tipped, so they might pick up this flag.
Owning defense, number 26. After this is to the bowl, automatic first down.
And the big news there, the automatic first down, first and goal.
Yeah, they would have, they called the holding rather than the pass interference. And so that's why that penalty stands. It doesn't matter if a ball's tipped, you can't hold. When a ball's tipped, then all bets are off as far as pass interference. But because it was a hold, then this penalty will stand.
It gives the Bearcats first and goal from the 3. And back to your earlier point about running the quarterback, Kolaris.
This would be a good time to do it. And they're still going to discuss this thing a little bit further.
Will we get further clarification from our referee, Tracy Jones?
The pass was tipped behind the line of scrimmage. We went forced to have the distance penalty, but it will be third down.
How is that not an automatic first down?
That's a, forgive me, that's a rule I've never heard of.
Well, it certainly changes things. We'll try to clarify exactly why, but it is third down, not first and goal, from the 3. Kolaris, deflected, incomplete. Julian Miller, number 97, the defensive tackle, got a hand on it.
West Virginia fakes the blitz, and then they back off, and that puts people in the throwing lanes, and in particular, Julian Miller. so they forced the field goal try here.
It's Tony Miliano, who hit four field goals last week at Pitt to tie the Cincinnati single game record. 20-yard attempt, but the movement and the flag is going to make this a little longer.
And it goes half the distance. You wonder if Butch Jones might want to go for it.
Defensive contact.
All right.
After distance to the goal.
Decision time again.
Yeah, now you're inside the 2-yard line here. You might think about going for this.
Yeah, I think he's going to
keep the kicker
call
out there,
yeah,
and get his points.
He's going to call a timeout,
yeah,
think about
and
this
I
one.
I think that's a good idea, because where that ball is at right there, you might be able to get yourself 6 points out of it.
We'll take a 30-second break, come back with a decision from Cincinnati.
How can you get a...